Would you be? I wouldn't be where I am today. And I was thinking the other day, you know, what if I woke up one morning and I knew that there just wasn't a God? I wouldn't have a purpose. I wouldn't have a reason to wake up in the morning. God is the reason I live. He's the reason I get up every morning. He's my drive. He's my purpose. And I'm so thankful for him. And a lot of you may know, a lot of you might not, but this week on Friday, my grandpa passed away from cancer, and there was a sweet testimony that came out of it, and my sister is going to come down and she's going to share that quickly with you, this sweet testimony that came out of it. Let's give her a hand. I just want to give God praise. Of course, our Papa Dryden Martin passed away Friday, and I went into the hospital Friday to see him, and this was before we knew he was going to pass, and I was just praying to God, asking God what he wanted me to do, because if he wanted me to pray, if he wanted me to pray for healing, I was going to do it, because more than anything, I wanted him healed. But God told me to bring his presence, and so it was me and my sister, and our cousin Heather was in the room with us, and I walked over to my papa and I grabbed his hand. And I told Haley and Heather, I said, we just need to praise God. Come over here with me. Grab his hand and we just need to praise God right here in this moment. Praise him. So we started praising God and worshiping him and asking God for the heavens to open and just for his presence and his peace to fall on us. And for the very first time, I started speaking in tongues. And my sister started speaking in tongues, and Heather was just laughing, and we were crying, and we were praising God, and we were giving him all the glory, because that's what he is. He needs the glory for this, even through the bad stuff. God deserves the glory, because he has a plan, and we need to trust his plan. And I just praise God for this moment, because my papa, he knew what we were doing, and you could just tell he was excited as we were just praising God with him for the very last time. And I can't wait to do it again. We're singing this song this morning because my grandpa was a broken vessel. He had a broken vessel, but he woke up whole. He woke up whole in the arms of our Jesus. And I'm so thankful.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty handed, but not forsaken. That saved a wretch like me. Whoa, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blessed. set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Ooh,
Lord, a hand clap of praise again. He's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. No greater song than Amazing Grace, talking about the grace of Jesus Christ. If it had not been for the Lord, if it had not been for His grace, where would we be this morning? We would be lost and we would be without hope. We would have no hope. There would be no hope for the redemption of sin. There would be no hope for a life eternal. There would be no hope for Haley and Bethany to see their grandfather again, or for Angie to see her father again. There would be no hope. I'm glad we have grace this morning. I'm glad there's a hope in Jesus Christ this morning. Amen? Now, this song may be a little new to you. We just want to all sing it together, though. It's going to be really easy. The song says, "Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. And let the blind say, I can see what the Lord has done in me."
Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich.
Blind.
Let the blind say, it's what the Lord has done in me.
Let's do it again, church. Let the weak say.
Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me.
Now we're going to Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Away the sin of the world. Leo talks about it so much, and I get to hear his preaching when we're in the car, and that's a lot of preaching. And he talks about John the Baptist, and he talks about John the Baptist seeing Jesus coming, but he didn't see his cousin anymore. He said, "Behold the Lamb." Behold the Lamb. And you know, there were people there that almost wanted to believe, I think, that John was the Messiah. He said, "Wait a minute. I love John the Baptist because he said, I know who I am and I know who I'm not." He said, "I know who I am. I can baptize you in water. I know who I am." He knew what he was called to do. But he said, but there's one coming after me. I'll tell you who I'm not. I'm not the Messiah. In fact, I can't even get down and unlatch his shoe. I know who I'm not. Behold, the Lamb of God, amen, who takes away the sin of the world. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated, church.
Behold the Lamb, I will worship, seated high upon the throne. Behold the Lamb, I will honor, and I'll glorify this worthy. Joy and laughter, he's the love that I'm after, the only thing that matters to me. He's in my sorrow, sees my tomorrow, and his ear, it's always listening. Behold the Lamb, I will worship, seated high upon the throne. Behold the Lamb, I will honor, and I'll glorify this worthy. God who is faithful, his name a tower proven to be strong. Listen, church, he's surely why I'm standing. My story's ending. The passion that compels me to get up and go on. Behold the Lamb, I will worship, seated high upon the throne. Behold the Lamb, I will honor, and I'll glorify this worthy. You know why? For he is
holy,
holy, and he is
marvelous.
Marvelous. He's my
strong tower. Righteous.
He's righteous. He's the
living word.
He is the living word.
Sacrifice.
He's been my sacrifice.
Restorer.
He's surely the restorer.
Broken
life.
worthy of your worship this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Turn to somebody close to you and say, I'm glad you came this morning. Now turn to somebody else, act like you really mean it this time. Give this praise team a great big hand of appreciation. Come on.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? My, my. What a wonderful presence that we have in this house today, of God's presence in our lives. Can you say amen to that? Oh, man, been an exciting week. God has done so much and blessed and just how God has touched our lives and blessed us. Can you say amen? And his grace is always sufficient. And he is always the equivalent to the requirement in your life. And we're glad for that. Can you say amen? Pastor Don and Sister Kathy, they're on their way home. They'll be here. I don't know exactly when. They didn't give me the exact time, but I'm ready for them anytime. So we're so glad that they're on their way home and had a great time of rest and relaxing and getting rejuvenated in the things of God. Got some things, as Pastor and I were talking the other day, the Lord's putting into their spirit. So I don't know what the rest of the year looks like to you, but I'm excited to hear what God is doing. Can you say amen to that? So good to be in the house of the Lord. It's such an honor to see Dana all the way from Lexington, Kentucky, to be with us. Absolutely. Absolutely. And so we're so glad for you being with us today. Honored to have you. I just want to encourage you to be ready this week when Pastor Don and Sister Kathy get back. I sensed just something in depth and changes and movement in when I was talking to them. So you need to be here in the upcoming services. Things are going to be changing, and God's going to do some marvelous things in your midst and for you. And you need to be a part of that. Can you say amen to them? Let's pray just for a moment before we break bread here. Father, I thank you for an opportunity to break bread with your people. I ask you, God, now to open the ears of the listener, not just with the outer ear, but with the inner ear of their spirit, God, that they may hear what you're really trying to say to them and how you're trying to move them and channel their lives, God. And I ask you to let their lives be transformed and be changed, God. Open our eyes that we may see, may we understand that we're going to see this morning, hopefully, God, by your presence, what we couldn't see before or were unable to. I ask you, God, to put a guard on my lips that I say nothing that does not bring you honor and glory and praise. And for all these things we ask in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. I'm going to ask you if you'll join me and open your Bibles to the book of John, the 9th chapter. I usually say at this juncture, whatever I lack in depth, I make up in length. But I hope this morning that the depth of where we're going to go with this will bless you and encourage you. There is so much that is tied into the New Testament writings that God has put in there. And we're so thankful for what God has opened up to us and helped us to see and understand. John chapter 9, and I want to begin reading at verse 1. I'm going to take my time as we move through this passage because there is so many layers here that we need to peel back just to get a greater depth and look at what Jesus is doing. And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I want to make a side note here and a clarification so you'll understand this. Neither this man, nor his parents, nor God are the reason for this man's blindness. Jesus is changing a consequence of Adam's fall, a miserable life fact, into a miracle. I can shout right there because that just blesses me. I want you to know that whatever state and condition you find yourself in, they are not a direct indication of your failure. They are an indication that Adam failed in the garden. But we have a second man, Adam.
whose name is Jesus. Can you say amen to that? Verse 4, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay. And he said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which by interpretation is sent. He went his way, therefore, and washed and came seeing. Turn to somebody and says, his eyes were open. I want you to see this in the volume that Jesus and the disciples and the people that were around Jesus at that moment had understanding of, that we sometimes in a Gentile ideology don't see the unfolding of everything that's taken place. It is important that we look at it. I want you to look because of a couple of things. I'm going to call them to your attention, and then we'll come back to them as we progress through this message this morning. I want you to look at verse 6 when he said he spat on the ground and made clay. Those are important words. Anointed his eyes of the blind man with clay. And then he tells the blind man to go wash in the pool of Siloam, which by interpretation is sent, and he went his way thereof, therefore wash and came seeing. There was so much in this. Now I've got to tell you that at the juncture that Jesus spat on the ground and made clay, if I'd have been the blind man, I would have probably been glad to be blind at that moment. It doesn't sound appealing to know that somebody lathered up, spit on the ground, made clay, and then rubbed them in your eyes. Doesn't sound like something we would like to have happen, except when he went and washed in the pool of Siloam, his eyes were open. We got to look at this just a moment. The pool of Siloam is an important factor in the residence of what Jesus is talking here. And if we miss this, we don't pull back some of the layers, we won't be able to shout like you're going to be able to shout in just a few moments here. You see, in 700 B.C., before Christ, Hezekiah became king of Israel. Just to his west was a kingdom called Assyria. Assyria had a king by the name of Sargon II. Hezekiah, because he understood the position of Israel in Jerusalem, understood that the Assyrians, because of their idolatry and because of their paganism, hated Israel. So Hezekiah made up his mind he was going to defend Israel, build a fortress that was capable of preserving them no matter what came against them. So what Hezekiah did is there was a stream called Gihon. Gihon was some distance away, but Hezekiah understood that you can go a long time without food, but you can't go very long without water. So Hezekiah understood that. He understood that the Assyrians, when they were coming in, would have to bring water with them. They would have to go somewhere to find more water, or they would have to dig wells in the desert, which would take time and effort and sometimes not even hit water. So Hezekiah did something really unique. He chose men that went and from the pool, the stream of Gihon to the pool of Siloam, which was in existence at that time, they went in and cut out of solid rock a quarter mile tunnel that led to the pool of Siloam. Remembering now that the pool of Siloam means sent. And so Hezekiah built that. It covers, the pool of Siloam covered probably at that time 3/4 of an acre of ground. And this is where Jesus said to the blind man after he spit on the ground and made clay and rubbed it in his eyes, Jesus told the blind man to go wash. Now I'm going to hypothesize just for a moment here. I think I can take a little bit of license and liberty since you and I were neither there when Jesus rubbed the clay into his eyes. I am just of the opinion
that the man had no eyes in his eye socket. I literally believe that when Jesus spit on the ground and made clay, put it into his eyes, that when the man washed, he was going to have eyeballs in his head. I don't think Jesus does anything halfway or by coincidence. Jesus told the blind man to go wash in the pool of Siloam. What the Jews understood in that day that you and I don't know for at this point, but I'm going to tell you, is that in the old oral reading of the law of God, in the Old Testament, the pool of Siloam was called the Messiah's pool.
Oh, okay.
I thought you might get into that just a little bit. Jesus understood it. Why? Because Jesus was Mashiach. He was Messiah. He was the promised one. He was the one called by God that this is when he comes, you'll know him. He'll be the Messiah. He'll lead you. He is the sent one. All through the Old Testament, the Bible calls the Messiah the sent one. And the Jews understood immediately that when Jesus told this man to go wash in the pool of Siloam, he was telling him, go wash in my pool. Go wash where I send you, the Messiah pool. The priests knew that. The people understood that. During the time that Jesus walked the face of the earth, the pool of Siloam was where the poor people and the blind and the lame came to bathe. Isn't that just like Jesus? He has a place for you. No matter what your default is, no matter what your handicap may be, there'll always be a place called the Messiah pool for you. This is important because it was at this place of the pool of Siloam that at the 50 days of Passover, the last day of the Passover was called Pentecost. It on this last day of the priests would go down all that last week to the pool of Siloam, and he would come down to that pool, and he would draw water from that in a golden vase that he pulled from the tabernacle. He'd fill it with water, and he would come back, and he'd pour it to the east and pour it to the west, because that's where all the adversaries would try to come in and destroy. And when they would do that, they would begin to sing and praise unto God. They would shout Isaiah chapter 12, therefore with joy shall we draw water out of the wells of salvation. Amen. So the priest would go down to the pool. Oh my God, somebody get this. He would go down to the pool of Siloam, which is Messiah's pool. They had to go down to the pool where the Messiah would go and where he would be. And they would have to bring that water back there. And when they'd bring that water back, they would pour it to the east and to the west. And they would say, with joy shall we draw water from the wells of salvation. Important. It was on this day, the 50th day of Passover. It's called Pentecost. It is the eighth day of the last week. Eight in the number in the Hebrew is the name of Jesus. Every letter in the Jewish alphabet not only has spiritual significance, but it has numerical value. And the word Jesus in the Hebrew meant eight. It was the number in the Hebraic alphabet. And the number eight means new beginnings. Oh, man, I'm hanging on here, folks. Just hang with me here. And on that eighth day of the last week, at the end of the 50 days of Passover on Pentecost, the priest would go down there with the multitude, and they would gather around, and he would draw water from that from the pool of Siloam, and he'd come back to the temple, and he'd begin to pour it out. He would pour it into the east and to the west. And it was on this occasion, right here, where the Bible said that Jesus, who usually sat and taught the people, stood up on his feet and cried out, if you can believe this, I am the water of life. Jesus began to express himself, and he began to understand that there was something else going on. Jesus stood usually in the temple. He would seat himself, and he would teach them, and they would talk about it. But in John chapter 7, you may want this later, verses 37 and 38, the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. You know what he's saying? He said, look, you're not going to have to go down to the Messiah pool anymore. You're not going to have to go back to the pool of Siloam that is called Messiah's pool anymore to get water. Because if you'll trust me and let me live in your life, I'm going to be rivers of living water. Rivers of living water. Jesus understood this. Remember the woman of Samaria at Jacob's well. In John chapter 4 and verse 10, Jesus said this, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith unto thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Jesus is simply saying, look, from now on, you don't have to go to the pool of Siloam. It took Hezekiah months to carve out of stone this stream that comes to the pool of Siloam, Messiah's pool, the sent one. But you don't have to wait anymore for the pool to go to it. The pool will be inside you. It'll be living water. It'll be rivers of living water flowing out of you. John, in his writings, in 1 John said, this is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus, not by water only, but by water and blood. Turn to somebody and say, water. Water becomes an important factor in this. Again, 1 John chapter 5 and verse 8, there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. These all three agree in one. Powerful. Jesus understood. He had been with the crowd every day when they went down to the pool of Siloam. He had seen them. He had walked with them through the 50 days of Passover. And then when the day of Pentecost, he could no longer forbear. He saw him bring the water back to the temple and pour it to the east and to the west. And Jesus had to make the declaration. You don't have to go to the pool of Siloam anymore. You don't have to go to this Messiah's pool to find help and wholeness and healing for you. If you know right now, I'm in your midst. I am the water of life. All you have to do is a taste of me. And if you'll taste of me, you'll never thirst again. Thirst again. This is the background that Jesus was dealing in. This is the background that the disciples understood. This is the background that the priest and the people understood when Jesus stood up on that day and said, I am the water of life. If you believe on me, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. When you understand that, then you go back to John chapter 9, and Jesus says to the man who was blind, he spits on the ground and he makes clay and he puts it in his eyes and tells him, go down to the pool of Siloam and wash that water and wash the clay out of your eyes. And when he did, he came back seeing. It is impressive, and I want you to get this so intently in your heart. Jesus makes a special emphasis about the water being important, that these three bear witness, the water and the Spirit and the blood, and that Jesus talked about that water of life can live inside you. Why is this such an issue? Why is this such an important factor that people needed to know that? Why is that imperative for Jesus to expound that and for the people to pull back the layers of all that? And look, let's read again John 9, 6 and 7. When he had spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay and anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay and said, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way therefore and washed and came seeing. I want you to understand the imperativeness of Jesus spitting on the ground. Keep this in your mind very carefully. Human saliva is comprised of 99.5% water. The DNA in the saliva originates from the white blood cells that are from the inner linings of the mouth. All the white blood cells are produced and derived from multipotent cells in the bone marrow. And Jesus talks about we're bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. So when Jesus spat on the ground and he made that spittle of clay, he was putting his DNA that was there by the saliva in his mouth on the ground. And when God touches clay, when God touches human nature, something has to change. Anybody in this room say amen to that?
So when Jesus spat on the ground, he was spitting his DNA on the ground, mingling it with clay, and then he rubbed it in the blind man's eyes and said, now you go down to Messiah's pool and you wash in there, because when you do, you're going to come away seeing. I promise you today, we need God's DNA in our lives more than we've ever needed it before. We are members of his body, flesh of his flesh, and bone of his bone. Why does he say that? Because blood is created from the marrow of the bone. It went through the butthole. Somebody say amen in this house. Listen to me. Jesus had the blood type of his father. I said Jesus had the blood type of his father. He didn't have the blood type of Joseph. He didn't have the blood type of Mary. He had the blood type of his father. He had God's DNA moving through his body. So when he spit into that dirt, it came to life. I said the dirt came to life. That's why Jesus says you need to be washed by the water of the Word. That's why you need to be baptized in the power of the Holy Spirit. If you'll do that, his life will permeate your life. See, we hear these things and we think about them, but we don't understand the potential. Listen to this. All those white blood cells that was in the mouth of Jesus that he spat on the ground are produced, and they derive from multipotent cells in the bone marrow. You know what that means? It means when that man went to the pool of Siloam to wash his eyes out, it was impossible not for him to come away see. Nothing was going to stop God's DNA from working. Nothing was going to prevent his miracle power from coming to life. Let me tell you, you're sitting in this room today. You have the life of Christ in you. You have more potent ability than you ever thought possible in a lifetime. It can heal you from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. It can transform you, revolutionize you, challenge you, and make you a new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm sorry, I'm getting a little excited about this. I must contain myself. Don't know how possible that is. Bone of his bone, I'm flesh of his flesh. I'm members of his body. That means his DNA is flowing through my body. No, I know you could cut me today and you could take my blood type and you could analyze it. You wouldn't see it, because things that are spiritual are hard to recognize with natural means. But inside me, where I'm born again, where the soul of my being exists, there is something churning down on the inside. I've let it be captive too long. I've let it hibernate too long. I've pushed it aside too long. But I made up my mind this morning, I'm going to open up Messiah's pool today. I'm going to let the water flow. I'm going to let his DNA come to life. And no matter what the devil tries to do to me, I'm greater on the inside than he is on the outside. I've told this story before, but it'll bear repetition. Just act like you've never heard it. I remember in about 1968, it might have been 1966, but it was around there. I was coming back from the West Coast and doing meetings. Back in the time that I started traveling and ministering, we had church every night and sometimes twice during the day. I estimated about 5 or 6 years ago, somebody asked me how many messages I've preached. That was at a point of about 45 years in ministry. I estimated that I've preached up to that point over 30,000 different messages in that lifetime. And I thought about preaching that, and I thought about what God had done in my life. And I remembered coming back across the desert late one night, headed to meetings in Oklahoma and in Texas. And I was driving down the road by myself, and I began to pray. And I was asking God, I needed direction. I was still young. I was pursuing it, and I didn't know for sure what the direction that God was leading me. And so I was praying, and I heard something so unusual. I heard something on the radio. Back in those times, we didn't have a lot of FM in the 60s. We had AM radio, and I heard a voice coming from Sabino Cunha, Coahuila, Mexico, 1490 on your dial, with over 100,000 watts of power going across the United States. I heard a man come on there. His name was Wolfman Jack. Now, I don't know about Wolfman Jack's proclivity to Christianity. Didn't care at that moment. I needed an answer from God. And the first thing he said when he got on the radio and began in his low, gruff voice, he quoted Ralph Waldo Emerson, "What lies behind you and what lies before you is only minor compared to what lies within you." I've got some news for you today. You may be discouraged, but there's something greater on the inside. You may be fighting obstacles, but there's an obstacle overcomer living on the inside of you. You may be fighting sickness and disease, but there's a disease healer and a whole man raiser inside you. You may feel like you're surrounded by death, but I'm telling you, there's a resurrection living on the inside of you. I don't know what you're faced with today, but let God's DNA come to life inside you. It'll change everything about you. Jesus spat on the ground. Now, you see, immediately after that, you read in this that the scribes and the Pharisees, they begin to question this young man about his healing. The only objection they could come up with is that he healed on the Sabbath. They said, "We know this man can't be of God because he healed on the Sabbath." Now, I don't know about anybody in this room. If I'm sick enough, I don't care what day God heals me on. But I mean, just think that just about it. These are wise, intelligent. They've graduated from the Stanford of their day. They've graduated from the Oxford of their community. And they're looking at this young man and say, he can't be of God, this Jesus, because he healed on the Sabbath. Now, I don't know about you, but it would seem to me they were educated beyond their intelligence. Because if Jesus wants to heal you on the Sabbath, I say, come on, Jesus, whatever you want to do. I don't care when he heals me, I know that he can heal me. Don't care when he delivers me, I know that he can deliver me. I don't think Israel minded when David slew the Goliath on what day that it was. I probably assume that they didn't care whether it was Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, or any day ending in day. I think they were glad to see Goliath gone. I don't know about you, I want God's DNA working inside me, living, multiplying. And it is potent, multipotent. What does that mean? It means that DNA in you, when something comes against you, begins to work even before you've asked him. What did the Bible say? It says, "You have not because you ask not. And you ask amiss, not knowing what the Spirit wants." I want you to know this. Jesus understands where you are, where you're going, where you've been, and what you're up to. So there's no need to try to con God. It just doesn't work. But down deep on the inside of you, the moment you said, "I accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of my life," something begins to unravel on the inside of you and begins to expand and begins to grow. What is that? It's the nature and the nurture of a living God that is not a God of the dead. He's a God of the living. So whatever you're dealing with, you need to shout victory unto God from with wells of joy shall we draw salvation. With joy shall we draw from the wells of salvation. I don't know that Hezekiah even understood the depth of what he was doing when he was digging the opening stream to the pool of Siloam out of solid rock over a quarter of a mile to the pool of Siloam. I don't know if he understood it, but he would soon find out. Sargon the II tried to take Israel, but couldn't do it. As a matter of fact, they died in the very desert they lived in. His next peer was Sennacherib, which you read about in the Bible. Sennacherib wanted to do the same thing, but he couldn't do it. As a matter of fact, his own household killed him. You see, when you come against the things of God, when you come against the Messiah pool, when you come against the place that God is developing his cell structure in you, and I'm not talking about a literal sense, I'm talking about spiritual growth on the inside of you. Do not spend the days of your life without ever getting into God's word and understanding understand that there's life in His Word. My words, they are spirit and they are life. It'll bring you deliverance in your soul and in your mind. Get down on your face before God and say, feed me with your Word. Yeah. Feed me with your Word. So he went and he washed in the pool of Siloam and he came back seeing. The Pharisees and the Sadducees questioned. They question his healing, his deliverance. I like this young man. As a matter of fact, they don't get the satisfactory answer from him, so they question his parents. They said to his parents, we just want to know, how is this? We know him. We've seen him. We know that he wasn't blind. See, I take the perspective that if he was faking blindness, they would have said that. But when you don't have any eyeballs and then you have eyeballs, you can't refute that. And they say to his parents that we just want to know. They said, we know not how all this took place. What we do know is that he was blind, but now he sees. But that didn't satisfy them. That didn't quench their curiosity and their doubts and their fears and their animosity toward Jesus. So they said to this young man, tell us again. Now, this is the third time he's been interrogated over a miracle. Let me say this. This might help you just a little bit. When God does something good to you, the devil's going to interrogate you, trying to make you doubt what God did. He's going to try to make you refute what God did. Remember the 10 lepers that came to Jesus? And Jesus had said, go back and show yourselves to the priest. And they did. And when they got back, they were all healed. But only one came back to praise him. Only one came back to thank him for what he had done. And Jesus said to him, you're a Samaritan. You're not even a Jew. You are an outsider to this group here. And yet you've come back. Where are the other nine? He says, I don't know where they're at. I just came back to praise you because I believe in a miracle. I don't know. I'm developing a message on the other nine lepers. I don't know for sure what their excuses were, but I can imagine. And one of them said, well, you know, I really wasn't as bad as I thought I was. It was more psychological. I really wasn't a leper. I was more psychologically affected. Or I like the one that I'm going to use a lot of is, man, if it wasn't for good luck, I'd have no luck at all. That he was just lucky, that he was just in the right place at the right time. No, you're not in the right place in the right time. You're in the right person at the right moment. And they say to this young man, tell us just one more time. They're trying to get him to be discouraged and refute his testimony. They said, tell us once again what happened. He said, all I know is I once was blind, but now I see. That's what you need to say to the devil every day of your life. I was blind once, devil, but I'm not blind anymore. I just used to couldn't see everything that you were doing, how you were working against me. But the master spit on the ground. He made some clay and put it into my eyes. And now you're not deceiving me any longer, devil. You're not tricking me and making me doubt. I see clearly now your presence. We are members of his body, bone of his bone, and flesh of his flesh. I've got to close. That means I'm working on an ending. Jesus spat on the ground and made clay. I don't know what happened between Jesus speaking to him and him going to the pool. But what I do know is that when he washed, he came away seeing. Let me close with this. Neither Sargon II, that was king of Assyria, nor Sennacherib, who was king of Assyria, neither Hezekiah, who was king of Israel, knew the eventuality of digging a tunnel and creating a 3/4-acre pool of Siloam. They had no idea that when Jesus came... See, sometimes what's happening to you is happening for you. See, they had no idea what they were doing. They thought they were just preserving Jerusalem. Well, Jerusalem was already going to be preserved because the Bible already prophesied that. We've seen that even when Jesus was crucified and he was buried and he resurrected, and 70 years later, Titus came in and tore the city of Jerusalem down. And yet we know today that Jerusalem still exists. Oh, you ought to shout on that. It doesn't make any difference how many Hitlers come, how many Mussolinis come, or how many Antichrists come. When God says a city is going to last, it's going to last. He brought life into the area. He brought life into their dreams and their ultimate thought. And he said, look, he said, I just make it what the enemy says. When I spit on the ground, I am creating a preventative thing in your life. Creating something preventative at the Pool of Siloam. There's people in your life that are doing things to you and for you that have no idea what God is going to provide for you. There's people coming against you in your life that are questioning you, challenging you, and you may not have all the answers, because Hezekiah didn't have all the answers. He didn't understand why Sennacherib and the Assyrians were against him. He didn't understand why all the Sargon II and the alien armies around him wanted Israel dead. But God knew that someday there was going to be victory in his camp. So let me close here. The day the priest came down to the Pool of Siloam and brought the golden pitcher back, they took it back to the temple. I can just imagine, having been on that very location, having stood there, having wondered if just maybe I was standing right where Jesus stood. Don't know, I can't prove that, except I did feel a tingling. That's as close as I'm going to get to that. Jesus stood up in the temple and said, on this great day of the feast, out of the belly shall flow rivers of living water. When you are inseparably linked to God, you are going to have rivers of living water. Can I take that one step further? And in closing, your children that are bone of your bone and flesh of your flesh, that have the DNA of the Father in them, has that blood type in them. The moment you get born again, your blood type changes spiritually. Your children are not only linked with you naturally, but they're linked with you spiritually. Oh, man, don't you give up on your kids. Because if you've changed spiritually, they change spiritually and they don't even know it. Because God's got his connections through you into them. That's why God said, I'll give you your household. I'll give you your family. Don't let the devil rob you of victory. Every time you see your kids, start rejoicing. Every time they come around you and they act like they shouldn't, or they act like they're full of the devil. I mean, I acted like that with my mother. I mean, I thought she was crazy. I got to tell you, I thought, man, she was out to lunch. I loved her, but she was crazy. I mean, I wouldn't bring any of my friends over to the house, because if I brought them to the house, I'll never forget the first time I brought a couple of my friends over, a couple of my buddies. They were just dudes, bad dudes, and they came to my house, and I introduced them to my mom, and my mom began to witness to them about Jesus. And they'd get uncomfortable, but before they'd get away, she'd pray for them. She'd lay hands on them. Man, I was trying to get out of the house without them being changed. But my mother laid hands on him and prayed for him. And then as we were walking out the door, she'd pray for Leo. God, don't let the devil have Leo. He's yours. But one day, her DNA took over. One day, the spiritual connection began to take over. And no matter how strong my rebellion was, no matter how strong my resistance was, no matter how strong my adversary was inside me, his DNA was greater than the powers of darkness. I know you want me to quit, but I'm not. I'm getting ready to. Something on the inside of us. Let me close with this, so I'll connect it together, and this will be my final closing. Every good preacher has seven. I've only had five. Listen to what Paul told Timothy. stir up the gift that is within you that your grandmother had. Stir up the gift within you. Two generations before Timothy came, there was already a connection. And two generations later, what was in his grandmother was coming to life on the inside of him. I don't know who in my family, how many generations goes back, but somewhere along the line, somebody had passed the genes on down. And DNA began to work. Even through alcoholic relatives, nothing could kill the DNA. Even when every obstacle seemed deterrent to destroy my life and take me in a different direction, there was a DNA that was at work that the devil couldn't kill and he couldn't stop and he couldn't destroy. And with Christ living in you, he is the hope of glory, and you have that inside you. Give the Lord a hand clap in this room. Amen to God. Amen to God. Stand with me to your feet, would you do? All across this room, stand with me. Paula, you and the praise team, if you'd come just for a few moments. Thank you, Jesus. The chains that seem to bind us, those chains, they're going to fail. They're going to be broken. They're going to be broken. Remember the man of Gadara? The Bible said they chained him, they fettered him, they put ropes on him, but nothing could bind him. Don't you think it's quite amazing that this man, that chains and ropes couldn't bind him, when he met Jesus, fell at the feet of Jesus. When chains couldn't bind him, when ropes couldn't fetter him, when the community was afraid of him, when his relatives wouldn't have anything to do with him, and everybody around him said he's a lost cause, when he saw Jesus, he ran and fell at the feet of Christ. He didn't bow to anybody else. Didn't bow to anybody else. They were afraid of him. He lived in the tombs. But when he saw Jesus, he became captivated. He became captured. He became connected. And the same Jesus is in this room today. Are you ready for God to do a work in your life? Sing a little bit of that chorus, Paula. Would you lead us in worship about the chains that we're free from the chains? Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Jesus, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break every chain.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
Come on, one more time together. In the name of Jesus.
There is
power.
In the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power. In the name of Jesus.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
back into the service just a few minutes ago when you were testifying and you and Haley were praying.
Oh, somebody listen to me.
While they were praying in that hospital room, there was a link that began to form between you and between Haley and between Dryden and between the people that were in that room. How did that take place?
Because the DNA was moving.
The DNA was coming together.
Oh, man.
See, they didn't know it at that very minute, but while the DNA was connecting, Dryden was connecting to the DNA in a higher platform. Things were changing in the atmosphere. I said things were changing in the atmosphere. Things were changing in the atmosphere. When they held hands and connected, the bond became, oh my goodness, the bond became greater. Because when you're connected to other DNA, when you're connected to the DNA that you're connected with, things begin to develop and take place in a room just like this. I want you to reach over and take somebody's hand beside you right now. Take somebody's hand beside you. We're going to sing this chorus just one more time. There's power in the name of Jesus. Your connection, your bonding, you get connected.
There is power.
Anything out of this? I just keep holding hands. Listen to this. I was in Des Moines, Iowa in the mid-70s. And at the end of the service, the Lord spoke to me and told me to have an altar service. I had looked up at the beginning of the service while I was ministering. I saw a young man come in, and his mother was with him. She was just a short lady, but she had him by the arm. He was a big, burly guy and just pulled him into the service. Made him sit down beside her. Never forget this as long as day I live. And I begin to pray inside, God, save him, raise him up. Let somebody in this service tonight minister to him. Let somebody in this service tonight minister to him and bring him to you. At the end of the service, I gave an altar call. And I just stood on the right-hand side. They were on the right-hand side in the back. I said, come down. I want to pray with you. I looked up, and she was out in the aisle pulling him. I'm not even exaggerating. I couldn't make this up. She was pulling him down the aisle. And I mean, he could have picked her up and threw her out the door. But he couldn't resist her. She just pulled him all the way down to the front. Chuck, I mean, she pulled him by the hand. And I'm thinking, dear God in heaven, the closer he gets to the front, the madder he looks. I said, oh, Lord, send one of the ushers over to him to pray and minister to him. God, send somebody out of the audience, God, that'll come over to minister to him. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to pray for him. I said, he don't like me, Jesus. He doesn't like me. I know he doesn't like me. I can just tell he's looking right at me right now, God. Send an usher. Send an usher. Send two or three ushers, God. Pray for him. I prayed that prayer. I'll never forget that. The Lord said, no, I want you to pray for him. I remember I got down off the platform headed toward him. I could see in his countenance he knew what I was going to do. I could see in his mama's countenance she knew what I was going to do. So she got in behind him and put both of her hands on his back. I walked over to him, and by the time I got over to him and laid my hand on his chest to pray for him, he began to bawl like a baby. He began to cry and sob like I'd never seen a man cry and sob before. And I wondered what had happened. I look back now, I understand. Her DNA was flowing through him. My DNA was flowing through him in the Spirit. There was nothing he could do to resist it. There was nothing he could do to stop the flow of the Holy Spirit. And he gave his heart to Jesus and got born again, melted inside him. There's power in the name of Jesus. I said there's power.
There is power.
you holding your hands on an awful long time. Just bear with me one more moment. Put your hands back to somebody. Get a hold of somebody. Because we're going to pray. We're going to release the DNA that's in you. We're going to release the DNA that's in you to the person whose hands you're holding. They're going to release their DNA into you because there's a spiritual atmosphere here. There's the blood of Jesus Christ in this room, and it covers everything. Can you say amen? Are you ready to receive from God today? I said, are you ready to receive from God today? Get ready. Say this out loud with me. Pray this out loud. Say, Father God, in the name of your Son Jesus, I receive what you have for me. On either side of me is your people. So I receive from them what you put inside them. Because God, what's on the inside always has to come to the outside. And so in the name of Jesus, I receive that. What you put into them. The strength, the power, and the anointing. It's mine right now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Throw your hands up and begin to praise Him. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's power in the name of Jesus. Come on. Sing it.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
I said there's power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Watch this. I saved this last little bit just for you. Okay? Remember when Cain slew Abel? God found Cain, said, Cain, what did you do? I didn't do anything. You know what God said? The blood of your brother crieth out. Oh my goodness. That was a perfect time to shout right there. The blood of your brother cries out. The DNA of your brother, the power of my presence in your brother is crying out. There ain't no place you can hide, Cain, that my presence won't find you. So your sons and daughters can be anywhere in the world, but there's no place they can hide from the presence of God because you've got His DNA in you. Things are about to change. There's a royal army rising up. Come on. And worship God one more time in His house. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah, Father. Thank you, God. 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 Praise God. Did you get anything out of this morning? Give the Lord a hand clap off you one more time.